Okay, thank you very much for asking me to speak this evening. Orthopaedic surgeon, back pain, it's not a favourite topic, but I'll try and give you some understanding of the things we consider when we're seeing patients with back pain. As most spine surgeons feel, predominantly leg pain surgeons, we're reasonably good at improving people's leg pain. Sometimes when you improve the leg pain, you also improve the back pain, but somebody who has predominantly back pain, it's a different surgical concept, and the chances of curing them we'll see, but they're fairly low, and yet your heart does sink when someone comes in with purely back pain if you've not managed to filter them out before they get to that stage. That said, there are certain patients, if you can identify them, which is the key, who may well benefit, certainly in the short term, from surgery, so I don't think it should be a completely nihilistic approach. I was at the Scintillating Sounding Society for Back Pain Research last week, which was in Dublin. This was a kind of meeting of minds of all the people involved in back pain research, and a lot of psychologists who feel that the psychology side of it is going out a little bit and they're trying to push their role, and a lot of physiotherapists. But in terms of back pain surgery, over the 2 days there were no presentations at all on surgical options, so I don't know if that tells you that we're not particularly strong in research or there's nothing really coming through, but I thought that was a little bit depressing from my point of view, or maybe it's good. There's lots of causes of back pain. The main one I'm going to cover tonight is degenerative back pain, which is the most common thing that we see. I'm going to touch a little bit on osteoporosis because there are certain patients that really struggle with osteoporotic fractures, and there are perhaps things that we can offer for them, so I'll try and let you know my thoughts on that. Obviously trauma, infection, tumour are other causes. I'll not go through those tonight though. If we think about degenerative back pain, there's a wide range of pathologies. You can have the so-called isolated disc disease. We have a single disc that appears to be abnormal on the MRI and the rest of the back appears to be normal. If you believe that, then some people would target just the disc in the hope that may improve things. You get spondylosis, which is a more generalized wear and tear or osteoarthritis and degeneration in the spine. Facet disease, which I think is much loved of the pain physicians. And we orthopedic surgeons tend not to target the facet, but it obviously is part of the pathology, and you know, you do see significant problems with it. I'm not sure I'm completely confident at diagnosing facet pain, but I have referred a few on, so I'm not sure what the feedback from those is. And then you've got more structural abnormalities, spondylolysis, where you've got a lucency or a stress fracture in the pars of the back, or spondylolisthesis, where the actual vertebrae have slipped out of line with each other. And while these can cause nerve root compression, they can also cause back pain in itself. I'm not going to talk about scoliosis, it's a huge topic, and sacroiliac disease I'll not go through tonight, but these are the degenerative potential problems. From a surgical point of view, we've got a wide range of surgical options. We can choose to fuse the back, or we can choose to not fuse the back. Be slightly facetious, but there isn't a huge amount beyond that, and you know, there are variations on the theme, but we don't have a huge armamentarium. However, you can fuse with instruments where you're putting metalwork into the back. It's more expensive. Or you can fuse without instruments where you're just putting bone graft in and hope it fuses. You can decide where you fuse. You can do a posterolateral fusion, which is the most common one, where you put bone graft in just at the back. You can do interbody fusion, where you take out the disc and put something between the vertebrae to try and fuse there. Or you can do 360 degrees, which is a fancy way of saying that you're going to do both. And then it's how long do you fuse? Do you do a short segment fusion? Do you do a long segment fusion? Or do you do a short segment fusion, come back a few years later and extend it, which is often the case, unfortunately. If we think about the non-fusion options, disc replacement is something it's been around for probably 10 to 15 years, and it's quite in vogue just now. In the lumbar spine, there's perhaps one centre in Scotland that's putting in lumbar disc replacements up in Aberdeen. It's not really used anywhere else, but having spent a year in England, it's certainly more established down there. Whether that's relating to private practice or the tariff associated with it for the hospitals, I'm not sure, but I think the evidence isn't all that strong, but I'll talk a little bit more about it later on. You can have dynamic stabilization, where you try and reduce the movement in the spine, but you don't formally fuse it, or intradiscal techniques, where you do something to the disc to try and improve the pain. I'm just going to quickly go over investigations. The old-fashioned and much maligned lumbar x-ray is cheap. It's available, although it can be difficult now if you request it. They're often knocked back if you've not got a good indication, because it does involve ionizing radiation. But it's useful because it can be done standing, which gives you an idea of what the patient's mechanical axis is like when they're in the standing or functional position. Or it can be dynamic, so you can get a flexion extension views which may show some instability that isn't obvious otherwise. It can also show lumbar disc degeneration with osteophytes, end plate sclerosis, and disc space narrowing, which are all fairly nonspecific, but certainly with disc space narrowing, there is a strong association with associated back pain with that. Are they useful? Well, from the surgeon point of view, yes, they are, because they give you an assessment of deformity. All scoliosis surgeons will get standing x-rays prior to considering surgery. It also gives you an idea of stability and helps with your surgical planning, you know, what you might realistically be able to do and what you're going to be targeting. However, it doesn't give you a specific diagnosis. Most of the time, perhaps osteoporotic fractures you can pick up. You can't really exclude serious pathology if you're considering the other causes of back pain. And in the NICE guidelines for non-specific low back pain, it's contraindicated, so you wouldn't get support if you ordered one on that basis. Nonetheless, sometimes for a patient, it's useful to get some sort of investigation. It's a fairly straightforward one that may be reassuring for them. MRI scan, the most popular choice when it's available. It's non-ionizing, it's very sensitive, it's good for assessing the soft tissues. It's usually done supine, which again, you could have a spine that looks normal and you get a standing x-ray and they've got a spondylolisthesis or a slip that wasn't obvious. But it's very sensitive and very useful. You can identify a surgical target with it. It might show you a disc that looks normal on an x-ray and you've got end plate changes or modic changes, edema around about it, which suggests there's an inflammatory process. It can show you effusions in the facet joints. It can show you it can show you red flag problems, you know, tumors or other problems like that. And from that point of view, it's good as a screening tool. So if you've got somebody who's got some red flags you're concerned about, it's a general screening tool. If you get an MRI scan of the spine and do a myeloma screen, you won't miss many things. However, it's static. You can underestimate the nerve root compression. We often find that the reports of MRI scans don't really give you a full idea of what the potential nerve root compression is. If we're thinking more about radicular pain, so you have to think, well, what are they like in a standing position? It may well be exaggerated on that. The same goes for deformity. Somebody might have a relatively straight spine when they're lying down. When they stand up, they develop a curve. And it's not tolerated in probably around 10% of people through claustrophobia and perhaps a few more through other contraindications. CT is another option. It's available. It's better tolerated than MRI scan because the tube that you sit in is usually much larger. It's very sensitive for bone or joint disease. You can get very nice pictures of the joints themselves. You can see subtle arthritic changes. It does give you a restricted assessment for soft tissues. You can see discs and nerve roots and things like that, but it's not easy to interpret them. And again, it's usually done supine, although occasionally you can, in some centers, get standing or sitting CTs. And it does involve ionizing radiation, although the dose has come down in years as they develop the scanners better. But it's still useful. It gives you bony definition from our point of view, for surgical planning, to where to put your screws, particularly if you've got a deformed spine that isn't normal and your landmarks are not normal. It can be very helpful. There's a vogue for navigated surgery where you use computers and scans to put your screws in without hitting anything important like major blood vessels or nerve roots. With a myelogram, so if you inject dye into the canal itself, it can give you a very good idea of what the stenosis is like. And SPECT CT, so if you combine it with an isotope scan, you can get lovely pictures like the ones demonstrated here. And what that's showing is the facet joint lighting up, which is the presumed source of this patient's problem. So it can be very useful as a screening tool. However, it can be difficult to interpret. You can spend a long time poring over the images and the radiologist will point things out and suddenly it's obvious, but it's difficult. And you may miss certain subtle tumours in the neural tissues that an MRI scan would pick up. Other investigations, thinking more specifically about back pain, discography has been one of the stalwarts of investigations in recent years. It's very specific and targeted. You identify a disc you think is the problem. You then directly stimulate it. You place a needle into the disc. You inject some saline or, in this case, some radiopaque dye into the disc to see if it reproduces the pain, which is the provocation side of it. And you're trying to reproduce concordant pain. You ask the patient, is this your normal pain? And you hope that they'll say yes, and that shows what's going on. Some people will then inject local anesthetic in to see if it takes the pain away, which again would perhaps give you some evidence that doing something to that disc would make them better. You can assess the morphology of the disc. You'll see fissures and tears in the annulus. However, it's invasive. it can potentially damage the disc. And I'll mention it in a wee minute that there is some evidence that if you do this into a normal disc otherwise, you can potentiate problems with it. There was a systematic review of this a few years ago, which said it's good evidence for diagnostic accuracy, and it may be an important tool for identifying things, so it is useful. They didn't say on its own this will tell you what to do for somebody that's got back pain, but it does show that most of the studies will suggest there's some use for it. The American Association of Neurosurgeons guideline update, however, which was published this year, suggests that there is some early evidence or some weak evidence that's gathering that if doing discography and discs can damage them, and particularly in America, if you think about the potential litigation that is therefore going out of fashion. They're thinking perhaps discoblock, which is rather than injecting dye, you just do a simple needle and inject local anesthetic, which is still invasive but less invasive, may have superior predictive value. So that may be the way we go if we're trying to pinpoint a surgical target. Think about what we can do. So spinal fusion is the main option we have. If you're fusing something, you're aiming to produce a bony bridge across a motion segment, in this case in the spine. You can instrument it, in which case you usually would use pedicle screws, which are placed from the back to the front, and rods joining the screws. You can put cages which sit between the vertebra, or a combination of these, and you also use bone graft, which you hope will eventually take over from the metalwork. If you put in bone graft and it doesn't fuse, the metalwork will eventually fail, so you have to consider carefully how you do it. In older patients, particularly if they've got osteoporosis, you can consider non-instrumented, which is a much less invasive, less time-consuming, less expensive procedure, where you just prepare the bone surface, put in graft, and hope that that will stabilize things. In terms of what graft you use, you can use autograft, which can be collected if you're doing a decompression and you're doing a laminectomy, you can collect the bone that you're removing and use that as graft material. Or you can take it from the iliac crest. The posterior iliac crest is very easily accessible when you're doing posterior spine work. However, you do get a lot of morbidity, and you may have seen patients that complain of immediate pain around the scar postoperatively. It's usually the worst pain, or they have longer term pain developing with scar sensitivity and potentially even neuropathic pain. You can use allograft, which can be pre-prepared, so you can get morselized bone graft, particularly from America. We can get fresh frozen, which is usually femoral heads that have been collected during total hip replacements. Synthetic grafts, which I tend to use at the moment, are a little bit more expensive, but there's no risk of bloodborne viruses. They're very safe to use, and the technology and evidence for them is pretty good, and you don't have the donor site morbidity. Or other agents, you've got your bone morphogenetic proteins, which are very popular and give you very good fusions. However, there are some risks, and some evidence that, particularly the earlier ones, the BMP2 can potentially cause bone tumour problems, so it's not something I would rush to use myself. If we're looking at what we're trying to achieve with a fusion, well, if you've got a spondylolisthesis, so if you've got a segment that's unstable, when somebody goes from sitting to standing and they get pain in their back because the spine is moving abnormally, you can try to stabilise that with fusion. If you're doing surgery where you're removing something, so you're removing a facet joint as part of your decompression or trying to take away the pain, or you're removing the disc, then if you don't do a fusion, you potentially leave them unstable at the risk of further pain or neurological problems. So that would be a reason to fuse. And again, if you're just doing a decompression without removing anything specific, you often will undermine the facet joint or remove a third or up to a half of the facet. It supposedly leaves them stable. But potentially if you decompress too much to make the nerve roots clear, you can lead to problems with back pain or instability. So that would be a potential reason to do it, to try and avoid that situation. I've put in grayed out, you can use it to correct deformity. So if you're doing a scoliotic correction, particularly degenerative scoliosis, you can correct and maintain the correction using a fusion, or you can prevent a deformity progression. So if you've got somebody who is kyphotic or is starting to develop a curve, you can fuse them to try and prevent that happening, although it can lead into further problems. Looking at the NICE guidelines on this in the early management of persistent non-specific low back pain, they're fairly vague about what they suggest for fusion. They say you can consider referring for an opinion on people who failed other measures and still have non-specific back pain, which they'd consider surgery for. So it's not particularly helpful. It kind of suggests it's a last resort. You can try it, but it may not be of much use. Patient selection is the key. What you really want is a way of identifying the patient that's going to do well with surgery. We do all these investigations to try and pinpoint a surgical target, to try and make up in our own minds what's required. So came across this pretty good systematic review published last year, which looked at MRI, provocative discography, facet joint blocks, orthosis immobilization, where they put them in a spinal brace to try and replicate the effect of fusion to see if that took the pain away, in the hope that if that did, then fusion would be successful. And temporary external fixation, where they put pedicle screws in through the skin and put rods on the outside, which is quite brave, but again, to try and replicate the fusion. Unfortunately, this found that there was no way really of finding predictable or effective treatment. So it's very disappointing that all the things we do that we think are helping decide on a patient don't seem to actually tell you who's going to do well from surgery. And we're perhaps kidding ourselves if we think that we're selecting the patients carefully. There are certain patients you see that you think you wouldn't operate on them ever. But there are certain patients that you know, they're quite compelling. You know, they're struggling, they're young, they have family issues, or young families, they're struggling with work, and you can find yourself being put under pressure or being tempted to try and do something. So you have to be very careful. Psychological evaluation, I think, is very useful. My colleague Tony Rees at the Western certainly tries to get everyone seen by a psychologist before he considers back pain surgery, although most of the time we try not to get to that situation at all and try and avoid the surgery. But in the patients that you are considering it on, I think it's useful to certainly consider psychological evaluation to get their support for surgery, although the access to psychologists can be a bit difficult. Looking more from the surgical side of view, what are your options? This is a posterolateral fusion, so pedicle screws are put down into the vertebra. It allows for some deformity correction. This is a grade 1 spondylolisthesis that has been improved slightly, but there was a large decompression with this as well. It gives you instant stability, so the patient's got confidence they can move straight away. I think that's very important. You see them post-op and they're worried, and you say, oh no, you can get up, you don't need a brace, you can walk around, you can do all the things you'd normally do. And I think that's very good from the mental point of view of recovery, and whether it actually has an effect, it does make them feel better straight away. You can maintain any restored lordosis, so the sagittal balance, the view you're looking at from the side, is it's very fashionable, particularly in France. They're very keen on sagittal balance, restoring lumbar lordosis, and they think that's the key to reducing problems with back pain or with a recurrence of back pain. And the key is to try and get your head essentially aligned above your pelvis with the curves in the correct places. So you can get rods that are already curved, or you can curve the rods to try and restore that, and putting metalwork in will maintain that. There is good evidence that you get higher rates of radiological fusion if you put instrumentation in. You get expensive implants. It takes longer to operate. They have higher risks, infection, nerve root injury, iatrogenic damage. You know, the best one in the world, you think you've put everything in perfectly, and you get a CT scan afterwards and the screws aren't quite where you're expecting. At meetings or teaching sessions, I have seen x-rays or images of screws pushing aorta out of the way and various other things, which is a little bit sobering. And as I said earlier, if the bone doesn't fuse, you will get metal fatigue in 18 months, 2 years or longer. So you have to be careful that if it doesn't work, you might have to go back in and do something else. You can leave them with a problem. Without instrumenting, it's quicker, cheaper. It's not much more than what you're doing. It tends not to be something you do specifically for back pain, but certainly if they have back pain as well as leg pain that you're addressing, you might consider it. Safer than osteoporotic bone. The screws that you put in, you can have problems with if the bone isn't strong enough. The screws can cut out and cause problems. You can get screws that you squirt cement down, but I don't think they're a great option. There's a lower radiological fusion rate, but similar clinical outcomes, so I think there's pretty good evidence to support doing it in the right patients. And if the bone doesn't fuse, you've not got the problem of broken metalwork in there, so you can get away with perhaps not having to do anything else. However, you can't correct or maintain correction, so if you have somebody that has a deformity, you're not going to be able to reduce that or hold any reduction unless you instrument. And most people would put them in some form of initial bracing, whether it's a corset or a proper orthosis, for usually between 6 weeks and 3 months. Where do you fuse? Well, posterolateral fusion, the most common choice. You use pedicle screws and rods. You put bone graft between the transverse processes. I don't know if you can see this. There's some graft starting to take. I don't know if the arrow is working. Just in the lateral gutter there between the transverse processes. Maybe not as obvious on that side. And hopefully that will form a good bony bridge on both sides and take over from the metal in time. You can use less invasive techniques. You can use percutaneous techniques or mini open techniques, or what they call a Wiltsy approach, where there's much less muscle stripping than you do with traditional approaches. You can't control the anterior column, so if there's major deformity you're trying to correct, you might struggle if you've not got any anterior column support, unless you put an interbody fusion cage. That may be something that has to be considered in addition. If you're going to do an interbody fusion, you can do A-lift, P-lift, T-lift, X-lift, D-lift, basically different directions from which you come from. So an A-lift, you come in through the front. It's either a trans or a retroperitoneal approach, excuse me. And it's very good. You get very good fusion with it. You get very good exposure. However, you've got some pretty major vessels sitting right in the front, particularly at the L4-5 level, where the vessels bifurcate. And you've also got important nerves, and you can have problems, particularly in men, with rates of up to 10% of retrograde ejaculation afterwards. So they have to be cancelled if you're going to consider that. And you do get problems with vascular injury during the procedure. So you would do it with a vascular surgeon or certainly a competent general surgeon standing by. However, you can combine it with pedicle screws or rods. You can restore the disc space height and support the anterior column. By restoring the disc space height, you restore the foraminal height, so that you indirectly decompress the frame on either side where the nerve root's exiting. You can correct some deformity. You can get some lordosis built into the cage itself, which can help correct the deformity. Or if you have a scoliosis, you can square up your disc space if it's been an asymmetric wear. And you can put bone graft between the vertebral bodies, and you get really good solid fusion here. And again, you can utilize less invasive techniques, and the T-lift and the X-lift are sort of specific techniques. You can come in using much less invasive ways. Again, there are problems with these, but done well, they can work very, very well. High mobility, depending on technique. The X-lift, again, there's maybe 10 to 15% of people will get thigh pain after this because you go through the lumbar or near the lumbar plexus. So you have to be very careful that you're not going to make them worse off than they are when they start. Looking at the fusion outcomes in chronic low back pain, typical to a lot of orthopedic work, there isn't a huge amount of evidence out there. This systematic review identified 4 reasonable RCTs, which showed some changes, but they concluded that surgery might be better than unstructured non-surgical care, but may or may not be better than structured cognitive behavior therapy, CBT specific for the fear of problems with your back or your back breaking, I think it was, back injury. So again, it's not particularly compelling evidence. There was another systematic review looking at fusion and non-surgical treatment for lumbar degenerative disease, looking at patients that had problems for more than 3 months. They collected the ODI, the Oswestry Disability Index score, which is a functional score with more than 12 months follow-up. And what they suggested, which I think is the important thing, that if you can identify a specific or established indication, spondylolisthesis, DDD, which is degenerative disc disease, then the patients may do quite well with it. If you're doing it in somebody who's got chronic low back pain and you haven't necessarily identified something specific, then they may not do as well. And I think that would fit with what most of us think. What we worry about with fusion is if you fuse a segment, you're immediately changing the biomechanics of the spine. You're going to be putting more stress and strain through the discs or the mobile segments on either side, and you can potentially be causing a problem. So if you're fusing somebody's back in a 30-year-old, you would tell them, listen, there's a very high chance we'll be operating on you again within 10 years because the disc above or the disc below is going to start to wear out and they might have problems. So you do a short fusion, then you go back, and if you know, you could go back in 2 or 3 more times potentially. So it's something we do concern ourselves with. However, there was a recently published study which shows that over the long term, although you do get changes on x-ray or MRI, actually clinically, this is an average 13 years of follow-up, there was no influence on the patient's self-rated outcomes of pain or disability. So perhaps it's something we worry about too much, and you've got to be careful not to treat the scans and the images. Lumbar disc arthroplasty, this is where you put a mobile implant between the vertebra. The aim of this is to try and maintain or correct or restore the spinal biomechanics. The idea of this is that you don't put the same stress and strain through the adjacent disc segments, so you'll get less wear and tear there. And if you've got isolated disc disease, this may be an indication. If you've got facet disease as well, then it's not something you do because you're not going to be reducing the strain through there. And it can be used at multiple levels, and I've certainly seen case studies of patients who've had them put in at two or three levels, patients in the 30s, which is fairly sporting, I think. They're expensive. A lot of the time, they will fuse anywhere you put them in, and there was certainly one study from New Zealand that suggested about 80% of them will fuse by 3 years. So the joke is that it's an expensive fusion device. However, it's quite widely used in England, so I think we'll wait and see what the longer term follow-up studies are there. But it does require an invasive anterior approach. You do have to do a lot of dissection of important structures to get into the front of the body to do it. So there are risks with it, and particularly if you're thinking about younger patients. There was this study published this year, or this meta-analysis, which identified seven RCTs looking at fusion versus disc replacement, which showed at 2 years it was safety and efficacy was comparable, and disc replacement probably looks better for physical function, reduced pain, and shorter stay in hospital. However, it's still unproven really what the longer term benefits of it are. So I think the jury's still out for most sensible surgeons. NICE guidelines, however, do support the use of arthroplasty, but they do stress that it has to be within a proper setup. So you do follow these patients up, you're recording the data, you look at it from an MDT point of view, so you're not just going gung-ho and putting them in anybody. And I think, you know, a fairly sensible approach, yes, it's useful, but we've got to collect the data and see what these are like in the longer term. So there may be some in the future, but I don't think just yet, certainly in this region. Non-rigid stabilization. We've got a variety of different products that have kind of come and gone from the market. This particular one is the Dynesis, which is two pedicle screws put in with a rod between them. It's basically a bit of cord with a plastic tubing over it. And the idea is that you reduce the motion between adjacent segments or minimize abnormal loading. You put it in under a general anesthetic. You can do a decompression at the same time, and you link the vertebrae together. So when your patient extends, which would normally reduce your foraminal height, potentially cause nerve root compression, stress your facet joints, this device will restrict your extension at that level, put less stress across your facets, maintain some of the canal width and the foraminal height. So it can be helpful if there's some stenosis as well. Again, longer term outcomes of these, not quite clear. NICE do, however, say that they can be useful for a proportion of patients with intractable back pain. And again, they say it should be very carefully selected patients. You should properly follow them up. They were quite in fashion maybe 5 years ago, that they're a bit less in fashion just now. But there should hopefully be some longer term studies which may change things. But it's certainly an option. It's less invasive than doing a fusion, and it's reversible. You just remove it and you're back to where you were. Looking at the more fancy, less surgical things, you can do things to the disc itself. You do percutaneous intradiscal electrothermy or radiofrequency ablation, where the idea is, or the theory is, that you have abnormal nerve growth into the disc caused by fissuring in the annulus, and this causes pain, causes you discogenic pain, because it's normally an aneural structure. So what you do is you put a probe in under local anesthetic with sedation, fluoroscopic guidance, use the x-ray machine to get the probe into the right place. You identify the right disc, you use your provocative discography to ensure that that's the pain that the patient's getting, and then you put a heating probe in and you basically fry the inside of the disc to destroy the nerve fibers. And it seems like a good theory. There are some reports of nerve injuries, most of them transient, but it's a fairly blind and it's an invasive procedure to the disc. NICE have looked at it. They said there's inconsistent evidence available for it. And again, they're a little bit more strict with this than they were with disc arthroplasty. It really should only be done within the confines of a research trial. However, it may be something that we come back at to look at in the future. Percutaneous nucleoplasty, something similar. On this time, you basically cut channels through the disc. It's a similar principle. You coagulate the tissue as it's withdrawn, and you're trying to get the disc to scar up, fibrose, and reduce the pain. And again, NICE's position on this is pretty similar to the radiofrequency. Inconsistent evidence, it may be something in it, but you've got to do it as part of a research trial, so it's not something that's happening locally as far as I know. Future developments, you get lots of headlines around stem cell transplant. Perhaps in rats it's been shown to regenerate worn out discs. So stem cells seem to be the answer for everything, but you know, certainly big centres like the Mayo Clinic are doing these studies. That's perhaps something that's going to come in. The big headline of last year was antibiotics for back pain. Sorry, apologies for choosing the Daily Mail logo there. But you know, they were claiming breakthrough could cure 40% of sufferers, so I thought I'd look a little bit more. I went to we have an annual or biannual meeting of spine surgeons, and the main author for this, Hannah Albert from Denmark, was present, and she gave quite a compelling and impassioned talk about it, and you came out of it thinking this perhaps is the answer for everything, but then when you have a little bit more time to think about it, you cool down a little bit. I'm sure you will have read about it. The idea is that this P. acnes bacteria has been isolated in discs that have been removed at a discectomy. This study was published last year to great acclaim. She was appearing on talk shows everywhere, I think. It was a double-blind RCT with 162 patients. All of them had chronic lower back pain for more than 6 months after previous disc herniation. Some of them had previous surgery for disc herniation and then had a recurrent herniation. They talked about modic type 1 changes in the vertebrae adjacent to herniation. The modic changes are seen on MRI. You get modic type 1 and type 2 and type 3. But what she said is she thinks they're all the same. It depends on the strength of your MRI scanner. So it may be any changes, inflammatory. It shows that there's some edema round about the disc. And they were given 100 days of antibiotics. It was Augmentin they used in Denmark, although they'd originally planned to use amoxicillin, but apparently it's not available in Denmark, versus placebo. And the patients were assessed at the start, at the end of treatment, and after a year. They got some very interesting results. Both groups were similar at the baseline. The antibiotics group improved extremely significantly on all outcomes, including leg pain, so back pain and leg pain, which is interesting. The improvement continued after the treatment had stopped, so between 100 days follow-up up to a year, they continued to improve. And there was a trend towards an improvement with the higher dose of antibiotics. So they concluded that the antibiotic protocol was significantly more effective than placebo for all their primary and secondary outcomes. Now, some of the problems are that they used two different doses of antibiotics. It wasn't powered for each dose, so it's an underpowered study from that point of view. I think there may well be something in this, but I don't think we're at the stage yet where we would consider doing it as a first-line treatment, although I know one or two people have tried it, but it's still fairly experimental. But I think there perhaps is something in this. Talking now about osteoporotic compression fractures, this is something everyone's very familiar with, I'm sure. Most of them settle with simple analgesia in time, and often we maybe haven't even identified them when they've happened. You'll see x-rays with established fractures that are old, and the patient, oh, I had some back pain for a month or two and it went away. But sometimes they can be very difficult. They can get really intractable pain that doesn't improve with opioids, or they don't tolerate the opioids and other options. And often they can be fairly frail patients with lots of comorbidities. So from our point of view, there are options, vertebroplasty and kyphoplasty, which may or may not be useful. Vertebroplasty is quite a nice technique. You put a cannula down the pedicle, the same way you put a pedicle screw in. It's percutaneous, you just make a very small incision in the skin. It can be done under local anaesthetic with sedation, or you can do it under general anaesthetic if they're fit for that. Some of the positioning on the table can be uncomfortable for them lying on the front, but the ones I've seen, they've all tolerated it reasonably well, as long as you've got a decent anaesthetist. It can be done as a day case procedure, you get them up walking straight away afterwards. And essentially what you do is you inject cement directly into the vertebral body itself, and we'd usually try and put a cannula in through each pedicle to try and get as much cement in as possible. And the theory is that it works as a grout, so it goes in and fills in any cracks in the vertebral body, stabilizes any micro motion that's perhaps causing some of the pain. Whether the heat of the cement does anything to the nerve endings, I don't know. But it's a reasonable technique, I think, to try for these patients. Kyphoplasty is a variation. It's a similar technique. You put the cannula down through the pedicle into the vertebral body. However, this time, you insert a balloon tamp. So it's a balloon that you then inflate under pressure. And the idea of this is twofold. It compacts the surrounding bone to create a cavity where you inject your cement. So you create more space, you put more cement in. By compacting the bone round about it, you reduce the risk of the cement leaking out. And also you can perhaps improve some of the alignment, so you can improve some of the kyphosis, and there is reasonable evidence that you can do this. So if you've got somebody that's got a very kyphotic spine, the more kyphosis they develop, the more risk they are from compression fractures, because you get unequal loading of the spine, so you get more anterior loading, so they're at risk of more problems. So if it works as they say it works, it perhaps is a useful way to do it. And you inject cement into the cavity itself. It's much more expensive than vertebroplasty. It's probably about £1,000 more. There are risks. There's a risk of infection anytime you do any of these things. That the cement, I think, has antibiotics in it. I'm not 100% sure about that. There are risks. You can get a cement embolus. The cement, if you get extravasation, it can go up in the spinal veins. And there have been fatal cases of this. You inject the cement under real-time screening using the C-arm, small amounts at a time, so you try and reduce the risk, but there are real risks. Or you can get embolus just from pushing the marrow and fat into the blood system, so you can get problems with that. If it leaks out, you can get problems with nerve roots, you get nerve irritation or nerve or cord compression. It's done in some places by pain anaesthetists, it's done in some places by radiologists. In Liverpool, we did it as a spinal surgeons, and the advantage there is that if there's a problem, you can go in and decompress the spine straight away, which perhaps reduces the risk. And the other risk is you can get adjacent vertebral fractures. If you're filling a bone full of cement, so you get making that bone harder than the surrounding bones, then you are perhaps increasing the risk of the surrounding bones fracturing as well. So you then start thinking, well, should we be doing this prophylactically? You can do it at several levels, probably up to 3 levels is reasonable in one sitting. Again, there's reasonable evidence that NICE have looked at. The last year was when they published the guidelines on it. They identified 9 RCTs, looking at a variety of different things, vertebroplasty versus placebo, which was a surgical intervention where they just injected local anesthetic into the bone. Vertebroplasty, just optimal pain management, whatever that's defined as. Kyphoplasty versus optimal pain management, vertebroplasty versus kyphoplasty. But the quality of the evidence was variable. They weren't all blinded. There was a lot of crossover, so the treatment arms changed depending on how the patients were randomised. So it wasn't compelling evidence. However, there is other evidence that improves mortality. Looking at the US Medicare registry data, where they followed patients up for 4 years, there was significant mortality benefit to the patients from both vertebroplasty and kyphoplasty. And whether this is because you can restore function or reduce the pain, reduce the analgesic use, I don't know, but certainly there is something in this, and it's been backed up by a further study which looked at another year, and also there's a smaller German study that's also looked at the same thing, so perhaps it is something we should be thinking about in the appropriate patients a little bit more. NICE concluded that it can be effective at reducing pain and perhaps restoring vertebral body height in patients who've got recent painful unhealed compression fractures. The way they phrased it was that we've been convinced, or it didn't sound like they were completely behind it, but there was enough evidence to support it just now. They think that there probably is some mortality benefit. They don't know if it's better or significantly better with kyphoplasty than with vertebroplasty, but it may well be. And they're not sure how much relevance this has to the NHS, but it may be something that's useful. Who to consider? There were radiologists doing it until recently. I'm not sure who's doing vertebroplasty in the region now, but it's something I'm wanting to develop a little bit more, because I think there are certain specific patients that really struggle to cope, and it's an option to consider. So if I was thinking about who I would be doing it on, and this is roughly in line with what the NICE guidelines are as well, it has to be the appropriate fracture or fractures. It has to be something stable, atraumatic, or low energy. You know, you wouldn't do this for an unstable spinal fracture. It has to be an insufficiency compression fracture. Preferably within 6 months. Now, the speed the system works at, invariably they'll come to you after that, but the fresher the fracture, the more likely you are to get some improvement in height if you're trying to restore height with kyphoplasty, but up to a year. That said, when I was in Liverpool, we did 1 or 2 over a year in the appropriate patients, and they seem to do reasonably well, so I think you can push it a little bit further. They've got to have appropriate clinical findings, so they've got to have pain at the site where the fracture is, whether this is pain on strong palpation of the vertebral or the spinous process, or whether it's they're localizing right to where the imaging shows that there is a fracture, because you get patients obviously with fairly non-specific back pain and they happen to have a vertebral fracture, so you don't want to be treating that and hoping that's going to help the back pain. And also an MRI scan with positive findings on the stir sequence at the appropriate level. So what that shows is that it's a fresh fracture. It shows that there's some edema, that it's not healed. The stir sequence, certainly in Glasgow, they're including a standard now in all the lumbar scan MRIs, so you don't need to specifically request that. But if a patient meets all of these criteria, they're fit enough for the procedure, then it's certainly worth considering. And it's perhaps a dangerous thing to offer, because I think, you know, there are a lot of patients out there that would want to consider it, but I think we're perhaps doing them a disservice by not making it an option that can be discussed. So I'm certainly happy to see people who may fit the criteria. Overall conclusions on back pain. I think if you can identify something wrong with a patient, then it might be an option. I think it's perhaps a last resort in non-specific low back pain, but I think, you know, you've got to get somebody on a good day to, or a bad day to, be persuaded to do it if you can't find a specific surgical target. And the key, as I said, is patient selection, and there's not great evidence that what we do and we think we're doing to select patients actually works particularly well, and the outcomes are very variable. I think the non-fusion options may be more attractive in the future. A lot of them are still experimental, but I suspect over the next few years that's going to improve, and we may get more compelling evidence that that's the way to go.